This panel is about election night and how we do what we do on election night. I work at CBS News on election night, helping call races. Anthony Salvanto is the editor of the CBS election night desk. It's an interesting evening, a kind of activity I would never have imagined. It's kind of like a political scientist's dream. We're mainlining data all night. Steve Kornacki works at MSNBC doing the, essentially the same thing. And our third panelist is Mark Penn. Mark was Bill Clinton's pollster in the White House, and he's worked for many political leaders and candidates over the years. Steve and Anthony are going to explain a bit about what we do on election night. How is it that at 5:15 the election's already over and only 1% of the votes are in? How do we make a projection? When do we not make a projection? What are the data that we're using, and how does that process work? And there's a big question behind that, because that's just the technology, but there's a big question about why are we doing what we're doing? Are we being responsible with what we're doing? And I think that's where Mark will start in. So I would like to start with Anthony and the CBS News desk and what it's like on election night.
It's a lot of me and Steve going back and forth, going, are we comfortable? Are we not comfortable? Is that right? Is that right? So look, when we're going to tell you somebody is won, we don't really get to be comfortable with maybe not probability. We have to be certain. So it's a slightly different threshold than a lot of what you see out there. Having said that, I do think our job increasingly is to tell people what is unfolding and what we are seeing, and really try to explain all the things that Steve just asked, which is, why can we make a projection and why can't we? What we do, essentially, is think about it a little bit differently than the projects, which are fantastic, that you just saw, which is to say, the votes are already done. They're already in. So if you think about it in a probability construct, I think, it's not that... Yeah. Oh, sorry. Am I not loud enough?
There you go.
I have to start over now.
Okay.
Oh, great. So look, the votes have been cast, right? The votes have been cast. The question is, as they are counted, and we don't know in particular where they'll be counted first or where they'll be counted last, the question you're really asking is, how much of what I'm seeing of this thing that's already happened will reveal to me what it'll look like when they're all counted, okay? And in that sense, it's a sampling problem. So what we do is we already have what we hope is a representative sample of precincts throughout the state. And those precincts have had interviewers deployed to them. That's what you see when you see the exit poll. Those folks have been sampled as they're leaving the polling place, and then their votes are recorded and relayed back to us. And then in a lot of those precincts, and actually in additional precincts, we've got an interviewer who goes and gets the vote count from the precinct official. And that's one way that you see the networks a lot faster with what they're saying about the race than somebody who's just waiting for the counties to report publicly what's happening. So we've got these folks on the ground at the precinct, and they're getting the count from the precinct, relaying that back to us. Because we've already sampled the precincts, we can then bring that data back and take it and put it in, overlay it with the interviews that we've collected from that precinct. Now we've got the actual count. We have a sense of how good our interviews were throughout the day. And then we've got a precinct sample. Now we may or may not be able to project a race based on that precinct sample after the polls have closed. If we can't, then you're starting to look at county vote. And the county vote is what you all see. It's what you get on election night from a lot of different sources and websites. And there again, we're treating it like a sampling problem. How much of a county do we need to see before we feel like we have a good representation of that county? How much of the state's counties do we need to see before we feel like we have a good representation of the state? One of the things that was really confounding about what we saw unfold in 2016 was that Steve and I look for patterns, just like any sampling problem. You're looking for patterns. You're looking for confidence comes through, of course, consistency in what you're seeing, and of course it comes with having enough information. Well, what we were seeing was not terribly consistent in the sense that turnout was varied from place to place. You saw some counties that had quite high turnout. Orlando, for example, in the Orlando area, had higher turnout than the state average, or at least so it seemed as the night was going along. Some places didn't have as high turnout, a lot of rural counties, and yet the vote shift was greater. So Donald Trump was doing better than, say, Mitt Romney did. And those kinds of patterns didn't make for a lot of consistency going forward. So even as the votes were coming in, it was difficult to say whether we thought that the trend lines would carry through and project the race. However, we were able to say what was leaning and what was likely as things went forward. Now, I'll be happy to dive into particulars of states if you want over time, but that's sort of an overview, I think, to answer your question of a little bit of how we do what we do.
Steve, how did 2016 differ at the MSNBC desk in terms of like how you called the races, what was unusual in the data that was coming in, how you used the data to actually make the projections at MSNBC?
Yeah, I apologize first. I would have brought some slides of my own, but having spent a year with the horrible technology at MSNBC, I just kind of assume it'll break, so I don't bring anything with me. So my experience, that's a pretty good, I think, explanation just in general of kind of what's going on behind the scenes. And my experience is, we've got John Lipinski right here, sort of our elections guy behind the scenes. They've got a whole team up there. They're walled off from us, the actual decision desk at NBC, at MSNBC. I know during the Iowa caucuses, the leadoff event of the year, it was taking a while to call it for Cruz. Remember, Cruz won by about 3 points over Trump. At one point, I went up and interviewed John, and there was this whole procedure where we had to have the NBC lawyer escort me because I couldn't be in there without a chaperone. So we have a lot of separation there. So there's a lot of, as election night 2016, as the general election was kind of coming to a head, 10, 11 o'clock at night, we were making a lot of phone calls to the decision desk, just sort of trying to get a sense from them, hey, here's what we're seeing, the folks I'm with just off the set there, here's what we're seeing in Pennsylvania, in Wisconsin, in Florida, wherever, what are you seeing, what's the delay, that sort of thing. So that was the kind of conversation, communication we were having. In terms of my piece of it, yeah, I mean, what I was looking at mainly to inform my work on air on election night, besides what we're getting from the decision desk, are two things. One, obviously, is the exit polls. We get the exit polls. We start to get them a little after 5 o'clock. And I think, as you all probably know, the exit polls that we got at 5 o'clock looked an awful lot like the polls had during the campaign. So I think we all came in with a certain expectation of where things were likely to go on election night. And the exit polls suggested, yeah, that's probably about where they're going to go. So I think that put us in a position, certainly put me in a position, where when the votes started to come in a couple hours later, we were sort of expecting to see it go a certain direction. And I can remember the turning point for me in terms of saying, I think something else might be going on here, is when I was looking at Florida. We'd all heard all of the talk about the early vote in Florida, and does that mean something? Is there a huge advantage here, a huge built-in advantage for the Clinton campaign? The exit polls looked like she could certainly win it. And I took a look early. You get numbers early in Florida. Say we look at the counties, that's the second thing I'm kind of looking at. It's when the results start coming in by county, compare them to expectations, compare them to past elections, that sort of thing. I'm looking at the vote that's coming in Florida early, those three counties sort of in the southeastern part of the state, Miami-Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach, and I'm seeing, look, that's the heart of sort of Democratic, blue Florida. And the question there was, could Hillary Clinton, could she match, could she exceed, how much could she exceed what Barack Obama got in 2012 when Obama won the state? It was a squeaker in 2012, but obviously going to be a good sign for Hillary Clinton if she's at Obama's level or ahead of it. And we were seeing early on, it looked like she was on pace maybe to, certainly to be on pace with it and probably to exceed it. So I'm thinking all the polls we've seen, all of the sort of, the way the expectations were set from the early vote, the exit poll, the early numbers we're getting out of those three counties. I did a hit at, I can't even remember the time, election night's kind of a blur, but one of the first hits I did, once the vote started coming in, We're looking at Florida and saying, you know, if the Clinton campaign's looking at these three counties, you know, they like what they're seeing right now. And within about 10 minutes of that, the popular vote tally for Florida kind of switched. Trump took the lead, and I said, well, I better look at this closer. And that's when I started to see, you know, some of the areas Anthony was talking about right there, and say, okay, something different might be going on here. And then it was almost like a cascade. Looked up at Virginia, and Virginia was this state that, you know, I think we, Tim Kaine's home state, obviously, a state that's been trending in the Democratic direction, you know, for the last couple, really decades. And there was an expectation Hillary Clinton could win by double digits there. And I'm looking at the suburbs around Richmond and sort of Republican suburbs, and you were thinking this profile of a suburbanite that typically votes Republican but that would be offended by Trump, white, college educated, that kind of thing. You heard so much talk about that. Well, you know, you weren't seeing the big shift in the Richmond suburbs that maybe we were expecting. So there was an indication. Then the night starts to wear on. We're looking at Pennsylvania. Again, we're looking at those suburbs right outside Pennsylvania, those four big counties right there. And, you know, again, supposed to be a huge shift to Hillary Clinton there. And you're getting these returns, and it's not as pronounced as expected. You started to see other things in Philadelphia itself. Not as much Philadelphia, but some of the other sort of the other big cities. You know, the Democrats are obviously doing, you know, big numbers, but not as big as maybe they were expecting. So you started to get a lot of these indications. And then obviously by, I don't know, 9:30 or so, it was clear we were in for a very different kind of election night. And from that point on, it was just communicating with the decision desk and looking at our own read of these counties. I remember there was, we got to the point where Pennsylvania was sitting at about, I think about 75,000 votes, I think was the margin for Trump. And most of it, just about all of it, looked like it was in. And I think at that point, even some of the other networks might have called it. And I remember we hadn't called it, and talking to the decision desk, and the issue there was the provisional ballots. If you look back, you know, 4 years ago in 2012, you hadn't had to worry about this in Pennsylvania before, but you've got tens of thousands of provisional ballots cast, especially in Philadelphia, that take weeks to count and certify. So there's a question there, you know, is this Trump margin going to be low enough where this provisional thing comes into play? If you think about it, that night it was about 75,000. That was the margin for Trump. It ended up being about 3 weeks later when the state finally certified the results, the margin came down to about 45,000. So there was a big, you know, a big chunk of it, about 40% of Trump's margin went away on provisional ballots. Obviously not enough to change the outcome, but that was another thing we didn't think going into the night we'd have to be worrying about, provisional ballots in Philadelphia.
Yeah, and let me riff on that for a second too, because we called Pennsylvania, I think it was like 245 or 250 in the morning, and that was a case where you couldn't figure out what was going to happen in one particular county just by everything else that you had seen already in the state. Because, and this was true in a lot of places, it was true for Miami, it was true for Orlando and Florida, as you mentioned, Hillary Clinton actually did pretty well in places like that. I mean, I would imagine if you were her campaign looking at vote targets, she actually performed okay in percentage terms. What we were sitting there doing is trying to figure out how many ballots could there possibly be in Philadelphia? How many could there possibly be in very particular counties where she was doing okay? And the reason that it came down to that is that she had done so poorly in so many other rural counties. In some of these maps that I could show you, but I can just tell you, across the way, I mean, I described it on that night as sort of death by a thousand paper cuts, where she underperformed even what Obama had done across all these smaller counties. Those in raw vote totals didn't add up to much for any one particular place, but overall it kind of went and swamped, and her areas just sort of shrunk back into just small urban cores, where then, as it turns out, we have an expected turnout. The places where Trump was doing well, turnout was floating around 0.98, 0.99, even a little bit higher than we expected. The places where she was doing her best were floating at around 0.95 of what we expected, 0.96. Doesn't sound like a lot, but it was just enough to put Trump over the top. And there again, because she kind of shrunk back to just these urban cores, we weren't necessarily able right away to see how the overall state patterns were developing.
So let me summarize a couple things and then follow up, and then we'll shift to Mark. So you have a set of statistical models that are based on past elections. Like, you start with 2012. Here's what 2012 looked like. Here's what we think 2016 will look like. If you look at maps of, say, the 24 to the 28 election from the New York Times, you'll see, like, everything shifting in the Obama direction from 2004 to 2008. And what was unusual about 2016 is how uneven those shifts were. They were not all the counties moving toward Trump or all the counties moving toward Clinton. It was some of them going dramatically more toward Clinton and some of them going dramatically more toward Trump, which is an unusual pattern. So the two things about the analytical side of this. So that sounds like you do a regression on vote share and you see how it fit, and that regression didn't work particularly well this time for projecting. One problem that I'd like to follow up on is, what do you do with absentee votes? Absentee voting has been growing since 2000 very rapidly, so it's something that's changing in the United States. There are a couple of states now that are all vote by mail. You can't do exit polls. The precinct election returns don't come in nice precincts. They come in a big county block. So what do you do about the absentees? That's the first question. And the second question is, what is up with the turnout model? How do you actually model turnout? That seems to be the hardest problem for the election night analysis, because you're making a projection about where the turnout is. And as you were saying, you're then asking how many ballots could she possibly win. But that's presumably based on some model. And if that model's wrong, how far off could your analytics be?
Very. Let me show you. Do you have there's a slide in here of North Carolina. I want to address the absentee problem first. I think it's the second North Carolina slide. Before Election Day, you might have seen, this one. Before Election Day, if you were tuned in, you saw me, Steve, others sitting there talking on and on about the Clinton lead in the early vote. And we knew from 2012 and 2008 that Democrats were supposedly very good at organizing, very good at getting people to vote early and absentee. And the question was, what size of a lead did she need in the absentee vote in order to make up what we expected would be a more heavy Trump vote on Election Day? The only way to measure that is by surveying in advance. You can't exit poll somebody, or at least we don't exit poll people who've been voting at early voting centers and who have been voting by mail. Now, the question becomes, what do you do with that data? How big is it? You can get a sense of that by most states will report how many absentee votes have been cast. So that's pretty easy. What kind of demographics should you weight that survey to? Well, here again, you can use the voter files to try to figure out who's cast their ballots and what kind of folks and what regions have cast their ballots. But of course, you don't know their vote, so that comes from a survey. In this case, we saw in North Carolina is a really instructive example. People thought, oh, she's got a built-in lead. Well, she did. It turned out to be 1 point. And frankly, a lot of the surveys of absentees had her with a larger lead than that in the absentee vote. And then on Election Day, it turns out she lost by double digits. So it wasn't nearly enough. Even on election night, this is a map I just rolled back to when there was 24. Go to the next one. That one. So I just rolled back to early in the night when there was only about a quarter of precincts reporting from North Carolina. And you start to see a map that looks pretty mixed, red and blue. That looks pretty good. Okay, so we can't call the race yet, but Clinton's in the mix here. The issue is most counties will count their absentee ballots first. So you get this dump of data and boom, maybe a good portion of your expected vote is in. And it's that early vote, which Clinton has some kind of a lead on. Okay, so she's leading or she's winning at that point. And the map even looks a little bluer than it turns out to be because all of that is absentee data. And so what you want to do is try to convey to people that what we're seeing is already, is the absentee vote has already been cast. And then as more data comes in, you get a better estimate.
I would just say bigger picture. One of my, I think everybody after the election sort of, what did we learn from this? What can we do to improve in the future? Where did we make mistakes? To me, the biggest thing I look back, just in general, I'm not saying anybody in particular, and certainly include myself in this, but one of the things that I look back and think we overplayed and that I regret and that I would do differently in the future is I think we overplayed the early vote. I think we overplayed analysis. And I understand it. It's almost like, you know, you're building up. It's like if you were building up to the Super Bowl and any new statistic you can get your hand on that's going to tell you, hey, are the Falcons going to win or the Patriots going to win? You're going to want to see it. You're going to want to talk about it. You're going to want to put it up there. And you're going to want to, you know, if it's going the way you want it to go, you're going to want it to have great meaning. If it's going, you know, against your candidate, you're going to want to. You're going to want to sort of poke holes in it. But I look back at it, and I think there was, just in general, I think there was, relative to the level of attention that all the early voting information got, relative to the hype that it generated, relative to how it set expectations, and I think, obviously, expectations that were not met on election night, I think there's too many questions right now about what it really means when we start getting that information to be playing it up as much as we are. So I think that's one of those that when I look ahead to future elections, that's something I'm gonna be keeping in mind.
And I think that comes back, too, to whether or not a sports analogy is really appropriate in this context. And I know they're fun, and I love, you know, I love sports as much as anybody. But it's not a game within, you know, within a prescribed set of rules. And so it's not necessarily, when you say, oh, she's already got votes in the bank, which is what a lot of us, you know, describe early vote is, okay, so that doesn't, you know, that doesn't necessarily determine the outcome, because you could have a flood of people show up on election day, as was the case here, and wash it out.
Right. I mean, we had these, how many times did you see stories where, you know, or headlines or whatever, where, you know, look, she's ahead by this much now, that means Trump has to win by 15 points here on election day to cancel it out. And in normal terms, winning by 15 points in a competitive state or district or whatever would be a big deal. But if you've taken all of her votes and cast them ahead of time, then maybe winning by 15 is nothing. I mean, so I think it's just one of those things. Yeah, I think we got to do some thinking about that going forward.
Right. It's the conversion of what would have been regular election day voters into absentees that you're seeing.
Right.
So you're not seeing anything additional.
It's the same people.
You're just, you know, it's back to the idea of it's just being revealed to you. You're seeing the same people. They just happen to vote early, and it's not going to change the outcome.
Mark?
I've been asked to give you guys a slight critique. So I actually think overall election night was pretty good this year. I mean, the result was coming in. It wasn't kind of what everybody expected as it unfolded. I thought the coverage was good. It pointed to that relatively early and explained it. I would say, look, election night has to have two basic metrics. One, as you point out, to what extent have you counted the vote before they're actually counted, right? And two, to what extent have you explained what happened when you understand what happened, right? So in the first part, the time between your ability to tell everybody what the outcome is and it being officially counted is shrinking. And so the value of that service as a service is in fact shrinking on election night. I think election, and consequently, we didn't really find out what the result was until it was actually counted, by and large, except in those places. So there wasn't much of a service that was provided in two. And then I'd say, did everybody clearly explain what was happening so that the voters would come back with I don't know how this guy won. There must have been Russians, or there must have been people who fixed the machines, right? I don't think that there was actually very good analysis of that, because, you know, when you breathe out, that's the result of what you breathe in. So think of election night as breathing out. Breathing out was pretty good, but all the stuff that was breathed in was polluted, right? Polls were polluted, the overview was polluted, the model said it was 90-10 when it was more 60-40, 55-45, the electoral college analysis was wrong. All of the setup, right, partially because, you know, in campaigns, I always say there was a campaign about the campaign and the actual campaign. The actual campaign is, you know, what do you think of my immigration plan? The campaign about the campaign is who's winning, who's negative. And who's winning and proving, everyone proving that they were winning, that there was no contest here, has become so big that it is that the campaign about the campaign almost now, you know, blots out the actual campaign. And so that sets a framework for you come election night that is actually the result not of an analytical battle, but of a political battle. And that's where you come out. I think part of what I think was missing was what I would call a series of hypotheses or models and counter models. So when I did this a couple of times for networks or channels, I did it obviously in 96, you know, for the president, and we won by a pretty significant margin, but not by the margin actually the polls predicted. The polls predicted 12 or 17. And on the night before the election, I told the president it was only 8 and that he was slightly behind 50 points. And I had a model, the president was actually asleep election eve. As soon as New Hampshire and Florida were going in our direction, I said, our models realized you can get up now, it's done, right? And so that's predicting the result before it's predicted because I had a model. And in fact, when people asked me about 2016, I said, New Hampshire is not New Hampshire anymore because of all these people from Massachusetts who moved in, but it's still closer than anything else you've got. So if early returns from New Hampshire come in, she's won by 6, over. He's won by 6, over. Even, bite your nails. Why? Because really, these elections are made up of a coherent set of groups that are then fragmented into the various states and have a mix. So the big warning sign here were the Ohio and Iowa polls. The polls were closing. They had closed. The question was, how could she have an overwhelming electoral lead when the polls were that close, right? And she really should have had about 10 points in the polls if she was going to have that kind of electoral lead, because what was happening is she was doing better in Republican states that was bringing the polls together, like Texas, and he was doing better in certain other states. So what happened here for them was, if I had a number of hypotheses on the board before election night, are women, in particular white women, going to switch to Hillary from the Republicans? Few people realize white women voted for Romney, like 53-40, something like that. Second, are Latinos going to turn out more and vote in a greater percentage because Trump has angered them or not? Will African Americans turn out in the same level that they voted for Barack Obama? Will working class whites, particularly in the Midwest, who did not vote for Romney, now switch to Trump? And then there could have been a couple of statewide things like the Cuban vote that would have required to. But if you had 4 hypotheses on the board, right, you would have then validated, as returns came in or not, those hypotheses and said, well, African Americans coming out, maybe they're down 1 point, right? You would have said, Latinos, we see a pattern here. He frankly is doing about what you'd expect, maybe a little better. White women were the surprise. You expected that they were going to collapse. That was a fundamental change in his direction. And obviously, the working class Barack Obama vote was disappearing. And it seems to me that that frame, because I think people didn't really construct enough hypotheses in which the Trump campaign had a strategy and the Hillary campaign had a strategy, and the reason why you have a bunch of conflicting things is some of those elements of each strategy were successful or unsuccessful at the same time. And so I think I always point, and I'll just close on this, I always say that isn't it amazing that billions of dollars were spent on this? Billions of dollars coverage, the campaigns themselves, and not a single person posted a memo the night before, forget about a year before, basically saying that Hillary could win the popular vote, he could win the Electoral College, here's why, here's the 2 or 3 groups. Not one person, right? How is that possible, right? So how is groupthink so big that no one posts a semi-coherent memo? I mean, a couple of people said, I thought Trump could win, but they were mostly in the Trump campaign, right? Bob Woodward, maybe, and you could say, you know, a couple of people kind of saw, but nobody went the 2 or 3 levels of analysis. Here's the vote, here's the Electoral College, here's the possible levers, here's how you play out the demographics, here's the breadcrumbs. The Ohio and Iowa polls, I believe, were the breadcrumbs, right? They were the only available breadcrumbs in this thing that I could say anybody in the world could have seen. and at least posited this as a hypothesis so that on election night, you'd say, is it this world or that world? And I think the closer we get to that for next time, the greater clarity there will be when the actual results come in.
So in the run-up to election day, we do simulations and practice alternatives. So clearly the news organizations have thought through what scenarios would there be. How valuable would it be, or do you think it would be possible for election, the days leading up to election night, to review what those possible scenarios are?
Well, who wants to go first to say we did? But
here's the one thing I'd say. I by the way, I think you make some valid points. And I think there is a huge big picture conversation about the media that I think flows out of 2012, and one of the lessons I think the media took out of 2012, which is there was so much sort of pushback or resistance from the Romney campaign and from Republicans to polls in the run-up to the 2012 election, showing Obama with a pretty comfortable advantage. And Republicans to the end, the Romney campaign to the end, saying we're going to win. And I think the iconic moment from 2012 that hung over this entire election in the eyes of the media was Karl Rove on the set of Fox News saying, hey, it's not over. They've called it. It's still not over. And I think that haunted media, big picture media, for this entire campaign. Nobody wanted to be Karl Rove. There was a lot of, it had polls that showed Hillary Clinton leading. I think it had a sense just based on all the reporting coming out of the Trump campaign that suggested not a lot of organization, maybe at least, not a lot of competence, that sort of thing. And nobody wanted to be the one who went out on the limb and said, hey, I know every single national poll out there says Hillary Clinton's ahead in this thing. I know she's leading in most of these battleground states right now. I know the Trump campaign doesn't look like it knows what it's doing, but I think he has a chance. I think there was a real sense that was sort of in people's minds that you risked being the next Karl Rove, the one who the day after the election, they're going to be recycling the clips of you saying that, and it's going to haunt you, and it's going to haunt your career for 4 years. So I do think there's something to that. However, the one thing I would say in our defense is, yes, we were looking at the polls. You're right. We were looking at Ohio. We were looking at Iowa. What were we seeing there? We were seeing working-class white voters. We were seeing non-college white voters. Those are states where you have a big chunk of those voters. Those are voters who had remained loyal to Democratic candidates, even as non-college white voters in other parts of the country hadn't. And we were definitely seeing this in the polls. I mean, I think in my mind, going into Election Day, Iowa was going to be a Donald Trump state. Ohio very likely was going to be a Trump state. I didn't think it was going to be the margin it ended up. But here was the thing we were also seeing. We were getting indications that the college-educated white vote, the suburban white vote, the white-collar white vote was going to swing much more toward Hillary Clinton than it actually did. And in the famous line from Chuck Schumer, the top Democrat in the Senate, about a week before the election, he was asked about the Pennsylvania Senate race. He said, look, the Trump campaign is talking up Pennsylvania. They're talking up non-college white, blue-collar white in Pennsylvania, southwest Pennsylvania. They think they can win the state. Are you worried that's going to hurt your Senate candidate? And Chuck Schumer's answer was, I'm not worried at all, because every vote they get in southwest Pennsylvania, we're flipping two in the Philadelphia suburbs. And there was evidence to suggest that was going to be the case. She was leading, Hillary Clinton was, to the extent you can rely on this. I'm just saying, not saying I believed it was absolutely going to happen, but there was evidence in the polls that she was going to do a lot better with college-educated white than she did. You know, and that's my moment. I said Richmond suburbs in Philadelphia on election night. When I saw the Philadelphia suburbs, I thought she's going to be winning by 20 points plus in the Philadelphia suburbs. I think the final margin for her in those four suburban counties, 14, 15 points, something like that. It had been 9 for Obama. Obama won those four suburban counties in PA by 9. I think Clinton won him by 15. I think the expectation was 20 plus. And that happened, that's writ large. That happened across the country.
Yeah, I mean, we tend to explain this thing by lighting up states on the electoral map and saying, get this one, get this one, get this one. You're right that it would be helpful to, if a big storm is coming, as I think one is, right, and that you see that the weather folks will put four lines on the map, right? Here's the European model, here's the American model, here's the whatever model. And it seems like the viewer will accept that. These are the ways the storm could track, and we don't know which one it can go. Some kind of equivalent, other than just having us stand and flip a state here, or flip a state there, I think would be valuable. I completely agree. And maybe that's dependent on the undecided voters, or that's dependent on a few folks who are softer supporters. And explaining that, I think, would be valuable. And the second part of it is, you know, you can't go into this with a sort of pretense that there's this standing truth that polls are either getting or not getting, i.e., there's this Clinton support, there's this Trump support, and it's just a question of margin of error or Trump voters missing from the polls, et cetera. The movement that we saw heading up to Election Day was, by every measure we have of it, real. So the lead that Clinton had, the national lead that she had of 6-8 points, as some survey showed, I believe was real, because it then shrunk back, and it continued to shrink back as we got closer to Election Day. You're right that the trends we saw in Ohio and in other places, our final Ohio had him going up there, as many others did, might have been said, okay, we should go back and look at Wisconsin again. We should go back and look at Michigan again. And I frankly wish I had polled there more. I wish a lot of people had polled there more. And that choice is partly on what we assume from past vote, which may not be the right assumption. But I think the other instructive thing is, you know, don't, why didn't anybody poll Minnesota, right? I didn't see any polls in Minnesota. I wish I'd polled in Minnesota. So let's, you know, let's cast the net a little bit wider and not take as many things for granted based on what we've seen in the past is also helpful.
But that, can I just quickly say, this is, when I say the my big picture critique of the media is we were sort of afraid to acknowledge that there even was a Trump scenario. Minnesota is a great example, because I remember this, and I again, I'm not trying to name names. I think this was a wide problem in the media. The Friday or the Saturday morning before the election, the Trump campaign decided at the last minute to go into Minnesota. And the reaction from the media, and a good gauge of it really, is just media folks on Twitter, was ridicule. It was absolute ridicule. These guys are clueless. Minnesota has not gone for a Republican candidate for president since 1972. It's true. It happens to be because Mondale was from there in 84. Otherwise, it would have been 84. But Minnesota is one of those states. You know, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, they had long streaks of going Democratic. But if you looked at them, 2004, Wisconsin was within a point. 2000, Wisconsin was within within 1 point. 2004, Minnesota was about a 2.5-3 point state. You know, Republicans hadn't won them, but Republicans had gotten closer. George W. Bush in 2004 had made inroads in those states with the working class white vote. So we just looked at it and we took, not since 1988 has it gone Republican. Impossible, impossible, impossible. We wouldn't consider. I remember there was a moment in the campaign when Trump went to Maine. Over the summer, Trump went to Portland, Maine. And the response that I picked up on from the media was, this was an example of the Trump campaign's cluelessness and stupidity, because he was in Portland, Maine. And of course, Maine is one of those two states that gives it out by congressional district, one electoral vote per congressional district. Well, Portland is the sort of white college educated, it's the heart of the white college educated congressional district. The other congressional district in Maine, Bangor, Lewiston, Auburn, is like 80% non-college white. That's the one Trump has a chance at. And so the media's reaction to that was, well, that's just stupid. Why isn't he in Bangor? He's in Portland. He's squandering this chance to get the electoral vote. Well, think about this. First of all, it's Maine. Whether you're in Bangor, whether you're in Lewiston or Portland, you know he was in Maine. Nobody I know in Maine said Donald Trump was in the first congressional district. No, they know he was in Maine, and it was huge news in Maine. Also, what we didn't think about was Portland. If you go to Portland instead of going to Bangor, what do you get? You get Boston media. They drive 2 hours. They're there. What does Boston media get you? It gets you Southern New Hampshire. If you're in Portland, what do you get? You get WMUR, Channel 9 from New Hampshire. They cover it. New Hampshire's a battleground state. So you are getting the district in rural Maine. You are getting New Hampshire, a key battleground state. You have a chance to win. And oh, by the way, when you looked at the final results, Trump could have won the state of Maine as a whole. So it was a good example to me of something was going on there, and we were so, there was a big narrative of just ridiculing the Trump campaign's cluelessness that missed it.
First of all, I think you're actually, your Karl Rove thing is interesting to me, the fear of being Karl Rove. See, the interesting thing is, and as I always tell people in the prediction world, if I tell somebody when it's sunny that it is going to be sunny, it's not worth anything. It is only valuable when it's sunny and I tell someone it's going to rain in 10 minutes and it does, right? That is the only value. So when you think about it, the whole value of predictive analytics and polling is to see the world that you don't see. And if you don't see the world as it could be in polling, and I would say to you, how could Hillary Clinton be up 6, 8, or 10 points if she is losing Iowa and Ohio, by almost double digits? Until you have analytically reconciled those facts, or decided which facts are true and false, or somehow reconciled them in a way that has a theory, then you're not using polling and analytics. You are instead using your gut, what you saw in the previous hour of MSNBC, what you learned, you know, you're not actually using any of the scientific tools that we have.
But look,
and so getting people to actually take the leap, be Karl Rove, and be wrong, is the whole value of this when you are right, right?
Well, okay.
Hey, I'm going to stop there and open it up for questions. Okay. And then you guys, because this could go on for a while. Oh, yeah. We'll just go up. We'll do both these. First.
Thank you all for your time. Mark, you had, to paraphrase, said that there's a coherent set of groups that are sort of fragmented across the country. And traditionally, political analysis has segmented them on age, race, education. There's some evidence to say that Trump's campaign did a good job segmenting across personality types and using sort of web traffic or other types of data. To what degree do you think that is sort of explaining what has happened, or is that an effective means of further sort of analyzing the political environment going forward?
Again, I'll go back. Look, even in 96, I had a survey that I called the Neuro Survey, in which I did a Myers-Briggs test in conjunction with people's political and lifestyle views to then craft messages to see if the swing voters had a different personality type. Now, having said that, there's some theory that with Cambridge Analytica, perhaps they had some super psychological model. You know, when you win, the 1,000 brilliant things get attributed to you, and when you lose, the opposite happens. I kind of think that he had a set of issues, immigration, trade, nationalism, law and order, being left behind, jobs, crime, and that those issues were pretty powerful for certain voters, and that the negative personal campaign, you know, tended to just cancel each other out. And that the decisive factor were these issues and how they affected a set of voters from Indiana, particularly from Indiana to Pennsylvania. So I think it's less about, quote, individual psychological targeted message profiling than it was about successfully putting together an issue set that had been sitting there that the elite Republicans would never have touched and the Democrats would never have combined in a unique way to cross over an unexpected set of voters.
Hi. First of all, I just wanted to note that I do think that Nate Silver, blessed be his name, did do a memo or a prediction that Trump could win the Electoral College and not the popular vote. So that idea was out there, and I think actually he zeroed in on Iowa as being an indicator of her being in trouble.
Well, he'll be here.
So yep. Defend himself better than I could. The other thing I wanted to say is a lot of people here, including Nate and Kirk, could speak to the way that sports analytics and politics analytics inform each other and kind of overlap, and we can use them in similar ways. And even I've actually come to believe that the journalism of sports and the journalism of political journalism have a lot in common, but except for election night, right? Which is what you guys pointed out. Like, on election night, there's no sports analog for something that's already been decided, right? Like, and so I was wondering if we can come up with a better metaphor, because it's true, you know, unlike that, you know, the in-game probability, like there's no chance for a last second, you know, buzzer beater. It's more like a scratch-off ticket, is what I came up with. Because you can't change anything, right? Like, you're just like, you know, if you're sitting there like, I hope the next one's a six, like, it's going to be what it is, you know? So, but I also liked the weather metaphor, too. But anyway, I just wanted to open that up. And also, I guess, kind of draw awareness to the fact that we as journalists, those of us who are journalists, like, need to keep in mind that election night is different than every other moment. Nothing can change, right? Unless the Russians hack everything, so which they did, obviously. So,
I love that, and I a graphic where it sort of scratches off a state, and it's Trump. You might see that.
It's true, but and people buy the scratch tickets though because of the illusion of suspense. Yeah, you know? At least I do.
Now, it's an interesting thing because this is like watching a football game and not knowing the score until it's over, even though you have watched the entire game. And there isn't anything else like that.
Let's just sweep around the room. So anybody over here? All right, we'll move over here.
Sure. First, thanks everybody for your commentary so far. I've got a question about, we've been asking a lot about the models and talking a lot about the models after the data has come in. But does this election actually bring into question the external validity of our polling procedures? And maybe the data itself was actually off. So curious what you guys have to say about the procedures, and do we need to look at some new changes going into the next election cycle?
Okay. First of all, predicting is not the same thing as understanding, right? We often mistake predicting for understanding. The idea that if we know the outcome, we can sort of back figure out how we got there. Okay. In the polling, you saw a larger number of undecided voters who switched at the last moment or decided at the last moment to go for Trump. And we saw that in Pennsylvania. The exit poll showed that. We saw that. It was particular in the upper Midwest. So to Mark's point about trying to figure out how we can infer one state, even we don't have a lot of polling, from other states because of the types of voters who live there, that could have been done better, or that could have been, we could have done more of that. The second thing is, our likely voter models told us a lot about how Democrats were going to turn out that, in fact, did not materialize in a lot of places. And that's one place. And when we talk about the polling, you know, always look at who's undecided and who could move, but also look at whether or not people who say they're going to vote actually profile like they will. Now, one of the things that was interesting here is that a lot of the folks in those polls did profile like they would vote. And I think we can look harder at whether or not enthusiasm this year, as opposed to in 2012, might have played a role for Democrats. But that, I think, was a big part of what you saw, where you saw maybe a 3 or 4 point in a lot of states, swing from what we thought Clinton would do to where she actually did. Where you see that dependent on, or you see that come back to turnout, that's where the mesh, you know, sort of didn't, where things didn't quite click. So in terms of particular polling procedures, I think those are a couple of places to look hard at.
But I think, too, the other issue is interpretation of the polls, because she was leading most of these swing states, not Iowa and not Ohio, but most of these swing states she was leading basically in every national poll. And she wins the popular vote. So I think the average of the national polls is something like 4 points or something going into Election Day. She wins the popular vote by a fairly comfortable margin. However, I think something we were missing in it, it stuck with me after the election. Kellyanne Conway used to be on our show, and she said a lot of things. But she said something that after the election, she would say something over and over again when we asked her about the polls during the campaign, and she would say, "Show me the poll that has Hillary Clinton over 50%. And at the time, I was like, "Well, she's up 6-7 points. You know, she can get there if she needs to, unless this third party." But she was not over 50%. And I went back and looked, and I could find one poll from like April on, when it clearly became a Trump-Clinton race, where she actually hit 50%. I think she was at 50 exactly. And the point I think that Kellyanne Conway was trying to make, and the point I take looking back, is when you look at all of the voters at the end, I think the people who made up their mind in the final week or the final days or whatever, who did not like either candidate, broke overwhelmingly to Donald Trump. And the Clinton people will tell you to this day, they think it's because of Comey, and they think it's because of the cloud that Comey put over her in the other day. I think an alternate explanation, and one thing that I think about after the election, is we've never really had a candidate like Hillary Clinton who, she had been on the national political stage for a quarter of a century by the time she was the Democratic nominee for president. I mean, she wasn't just the wife of the Democratic candidate in 1992 and the first lady in the 90s. She was a central policy-making player. She ran the healthcare task force. She's on the cover of Time magazine. She runs for the U.S. Senate. She runs for president. She becomes Secretary of State. I mean, usually there is a much shorter period of time from when somebody becomes a major. Barack Obama, nobody's heard of him until the summer of 2004. He's the Democratic nominee in 2008. Barack Obama was new. He was fresh. He was all of those things. This idea of people wanting to vote against the establishment, I cannot think of a candidate or a character in modern political history who, based on biography, embodied the establishment more than Hillary Clinton. And I think when you think of the inability to hit 50% during the campaign, and you think of all the voters who broke against her late, even the ones who did not like either one of them, I think that might have been something hanging in the air that we weren't fully aware of during the election.
Let's go to Hubert Humphrey, Walter Mondale. I mean, in fact, politics is littered with candidates who were Democratic frontrunners, who then were seen as the establishment candidate. Look, I think your point's exactly right. I think the polling was actually pretty good. No one really hit Indiana, and Evan Bayh thought he was winning in Indiana when Indiana was up to 20. That probably is the single largest polling gap that I don't think anybody's explained state by state. The polling was pretty good, and I completely agree with you. The analysis of the second level, and I think also you're right. There was no poll where she got above 50, but the question was Donald Trump stuck at 40? And he became a candidate once he got to 45, 46, 47 in polls. And then this thing about the popular vote, there's 6 million votes to a Libertarian candidate. Most of those are Republican votes. The notion she actually, quote, won the popular vote is, that just means she won a plurality. She we don't really know what the hidden Libertarian vote really was about, because the Republicans basically swept the rest of the night when you look at it. So there still was significantly more underlying popular strength for the Republican Party, if not Donald Trump. And she never got to 50, but the real thing that put him in the ring, I think, was the first poll that showed him over 45.
And that's a great point, too, because if you look at the Republican support for Trump throughout, in state after state, where he was at 80, 85%, and we all said, that's not good enough. There were all these Republicans, not necessarily conservative Republicans, hanging out there, didn't want to come to him, and then they did in the end when he got over 90%, and that alone explains a good part of the variance.
Great. We're going to stop there because we are at 10:55. It's time for a break. Thank you very much.